Education and construction materials are two key drivers of our next gas conglomerate. Publicly listed Finma Corp is now looking to restart business under loosened restrictions. With us now for more, Ramon Del Rosario Jr., President and CEO of Finma Group. Good to see you again, Ramon. Welcome to the program.
Good to see you, Kathy.
Right. So what do you make of the president's decision keeping the status quo and the quarantine restrictions in Metro Manila?
I think it was pretty much expected. We're coping and we're doing what we can under the circumstances. So I don't think that was a great surprise, quite honestly.
Well, we're now with one of the world's longest lockdowns. So what are you now doing to get around it?
Well, we are trying to be ready. Our businesses are in good position because, as you know, we have selected strategically businesses that are very high in the priority list of Filipinos. We're in education, we're in construction materials, we're in housing, and it's really our hospitality business that is most challenged. But in terms of our education business, we were close to ending the school year when the pandemic lockdown was first announced. So that did not affect the previous school year, but we missed the summer months altogether, but gives us time to prepare for the coming school year. And we are in contact with both DepEd and CHED on how we will proceed in the coming school year.
So how will you proceed, Ramon? I mean, the president has said, no vaccine, no school.
Yes, I know. We, however, continue to believe, and we are in dialogue, as I said, both with DepEd and CHED. There is a lot of data and a lot of studies available which says that there is equal danger to kids being out of school on a prolonged basis. First of all, this age bracket of, say, 6 to 18 years old is really not the most vulnerable. In fact, they're relatively not vulnerable to contamination of COVID. Secondly, a prolonged absence from school has very adverse effects both on learning and even on social factors, such as there is a higher possibility that some of the kids might drop out of school altogether. And in the case of female students, I am sorry to say that records show that for when there is prolonged absence from schooling, there is a higher incidence of unwanted pregnancies. On the other hand, it is possible to control the environment through hygienic measures like proper distancing, proper washing, and staggering the classes so that they are not in school all at the same time. Also, it is important to note that almost all of our ASEAN neighbors are either already starting school or will start ahead of us. If we start on August 24th, we will be the latest among the ASEAN schools. So we will have the opportunity also to watch the experience of these other schools. But in our case, through Philippine Business for Education, we are strongly advocating that the government reconsider the possibility of some face-to-face encounters instead of totally relying on online learning, particularly for those areas where the COVID situation is not serious. We would understand if the restrictions will apply, for example, to a place like Cebu, if it continues this way. But for the rest of the country, I think there are wider possibilities, and we hope that the government will reconsider. But of course, we are prepared to comply with whatever the government decides.
All right, so it's either way, and the message is very clear that students need to get back to school in some form. So what are you doing at Finma Education to try to show the government that it can work, that what you have in mind can work in the differing restrictions in various cities across the nation?
Well, we have developed a system where we will we have broken down the semester into 2 week chunks, and our kids will come to school if we are allowed only 4 days out of the 14 days, and we will have staggered schedules: a morning session from 7:30 to 11:30, and then an afternoon session from 1 to 5. And during the middle period, we will again clean up the facilities. Our classrooms will only have half of the number of students that they normally have. So because our classrooms are fairly large, we can accommodate about 25 with proper distancing based on World Health Organization guidelines. We also will give instructional materials so that during the 10 days that our kids will not be in school, they will continue learning through what we call an active learning process, where they will do worksheets, and we will also make available internet access to the kids in our schools for free. We are arranging to make this available, and we will help those who do not have the proper devices to acquire those devices at a very reasonable cost and on a prolonged payment basis. So these are some of the things we're doing. And then while in those hours when they are not in class, during those days when they are in the campus, we are also opening up some of the common spaces like gymnasiums, etc., with proper distancing so that the kids can hang out there and do their work with internet access, and they can do it under more favorable facilities. So those are some of the things. And we've shared these ideas both, as I said, with Ched and DepEd, and they're listening with very sympathetic ears. And we're hopeful, as I said, that we will be able to gain their consideration. But the most important thing is our other ASEAN neighbors are doing the same thing, and they're doing it earlier, so we will have the opportunity to watch how their experience works out.
What about the students and parents? How have they responded to that plan of yours of providing the sort of arrangement that will make it easier for them to have this sort of blended learning in the interim?
You know, let me just make one quick point further, Kathy. Our kids come from the D&E economic sectors, and most of them really have very, very crowded living conditions. So I would make the point that the kids are probably, to some extent, safer when they're in school because there's more distancing and an environment that is more controlled. And also, the parents have to get back to work because that is so essential for the family. So when you balance all of these things together, I think the case is made. The faculty, first of all, whom we have briefed on this process, is very responsive and very favorably inclined. The students are responding very well. We have early enrollment, and our initial numbers are quite encouraging, even if it's still very early, because we're targeting opening still the last week of August. So on the whole, I think the reaction has been very good. In fact, we think it will be something that will be attractive both to parents, faculty, and students, that they will see an environment and a campus that is very closely, carefully maintained so that we minimize the possibility of infection spreading.
Right. What about enrollment phase? Have you been able to dial that down with the blended learning?
Sorry?
Enrollment phase.
The enrollment phase?
Yeah, enrollment fees. Were you able to dial that down and make it more attractive to the parents and students to come back to work, to school?
We're already very low for private institutions, where our tuition is still only at about 15,000 pesos per semester, and that is really very low. And what we're offering is good value for money. In the areas where we are almost always the local educational institution with the lowest fees. So we are not increasing our fees. We are looking for ways to make it easier. And the kids, by the way, by not coming to school regularly, will be saving like 100 pesos a day for transportation expenses. And we will provide internet access for free, as I said earlier. So and we will not be able to accommodate the same number of students in our classes. So balancing all of these things together, we hope that our kids will understand that keeping the tuition where it is, and by the way, we also provide very generous scholarships to a lot of our children. So on the whole, our tuition is very affordable. We're keeping it where it is, and I think our kids realize that they're getting very good value for money based, for example, on the results of our test results in those professional exams, where in about 40 different tests last year, we had a 100% passing rate, and our overall employment rate of our kids after 1 year is 81%, which is not yet satisfactory, but which is very good considering many of our kids come to college really not very well prepared for college life. but we work with them over a 4 to 5 year period to get them ready for employment. And the record shows that they are not only able to pass those professional board exams, but they do get employed fairly quickly. So we're hoping that all of those factors together is what will encourage kids to enroll in our schools. And last year we had the record enrollment of about 74,200 students in our six campuses that we're already operating. We've added a seventh school, so we now have seven in the Philippines. And we now have one operating school in Indonesia. And our partners, the Asian Development Bank, the Dutch Development Finance Institution, FMO, and a company called KaizenWest, have put together a pool of funds that we can use for further expansions, both in the Philippines and throughout the region. And this, to me, is a very strong vote of confidence that they like what we're doing, they like our business model, and they have spoken, I guess, with their money rather than simply encouraging us with words. So we're very encouraged about our education business, and we very have high hopes that we will be able to get back on track fairly quickly.
Just a final point, Ramon. Prior to the pandemic, you had plans of listing both FINMA Education as well as PhilCement, another unit in your conglomerate. Are these plans still on, or will you be reassessing?
Well, we will watch to see how the coming school year, for example, for education pans out. If our hopes materialize, we are very much excited about the possibility of listing our education business. The education business will come first. Our construction materials business, particularly on the cement side, is still very young. We really just completed our terminal in Mariveles late last year, but the initial results are very encouraging. So that too, we hope to list in the coming years. But I think education will be first, because there we have a proven track record, and we have begun expanding, as I said earlier, in Southeast Asia. So yes, we continue to be very bullish about the prospects of listing as soon as possible.
Right, I wish you well in the plans there for the students, the teachers, the parents, and the schools. Thank you so much, Ramon. You keep well. Appreciate the opportunity. Ramon Del Rosario, Jr. of FINMA Corp.